Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Hello and welcome to the WrestleZone podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're back with a recap of WrestleZone's just past Saturday at the Hopeville Social Club in Inverurie, and it was a hot and wild night in Inverurie. It was roasting. I'm sweating. My hair's gone because of all the sweats. That's the absolute official canon reason for that. But no, it was an incredible night in Inverurie. Sold out crowd. The place was packed. The gunnels. And like I say, it was a very, very hot evening. I may mention that once or twice more during the show. But this is just a quick recap, 10 minutes or so, where I tell you about what happened at WrestleZone Live in Inverurie at Hopeville Social Club, because we're on the road to Halloween Hijinks next, which is coming up on the 21st of October. Tickets are still available. You could have got some tickets last Saturday in Inverurie, but that wasn't, if you haven't got them, there's still time. There's still time. Go get yourself a ticket. So let's look at the show. There was six matches on the main card, one VIP pre-show, and a lot happening. So I'll try and condense it as much as I possibly can. We will have a road trip episode of the SWN podcast. It should come out this Friday, I hope. I think, fingers crossed. Where we got some interviews as well with some of the guys at WrestleZone before the show. Thank you very much, WrestleZone, for being accommodating and allowing me a little bit extra time. Try and get some interviews. Some I'm going to have to edit a lot. Some are just going to be thrown out there, and you'll get to see it in the coming weeks as well on location for on location episodes, mini episodes of the podcast midweek as well. So there'll be a lot of stuff coming out from that show that you'll be able to watch and enjoy. In the meantime, I'm just here to give you a bit more of information about the results of the show itself. So let's kick off with the VIP ticket holder match. It was a triple threat, and what was interesting about this was announced by Blue Thunder. Martin Clunas was not the ring announcer for this particular match, as he was talking about the WrestleZone Training Academy. And what was the interesting thing about this match is when he brought out the competitors, you know, where they were from. Now, a lot of the time for a lot of the wrestlers in WrestleZone, they're generally Aberdeenshire based as well. And this match was, as it was announced, we had Tommy Raiden, Ellen, Aberdeenshire. Oliver Green, Elgin, Murray, and also Conor Malloy in the match as well, also from Murray as well. And then interestingly, Dennis Law pointed out that he was the referee for the match, and he's from White Hills, which is just kind of on that weird middle ground. I think it's just after the sign for Aberdeenshire. So it was a nice little, not even a coming together of the tri-counties, but it was kind of cool that these guys have went through the training academy and they're putting on this match. And they've all come from outskirts or outside of Aberdeen, which made it just all the more interesting for me as a massive nerd. So in that match, Conor Malloy defeated Oliver Green and Tommy Raiden, but it was a very hotly contested match. Right at the start, Conor Malloy took the initiative and gave Tommy Raiden a shotgun dropkick, which sent him out of the ring in the opening bell, which really showed that aggression that I was talking about in the preview that I thought it made a bit more of an aggressive side in this particular match. But it could have been anyone's. Really, there was a lot of near falls possibilities, match enders that could have taken place, but in the end it was Conor Malloy who picked up a pinfall win, and he's still marching towards cashing in that title opportunity. We still don't know when, still don't know where. Could he be looking to play spoiler Halloween Hijinks for Mickey Vago and Lost Boy Aspen? Could that be something that's happening? We don't know. It could be a triple threat at the last minute. Maybe he's gonna watch some Seth Rollins tapes. He's going to be trying to get some ideas there when it comes to cashing in a title opportunity. Because anytime, any place, I don't think that's really been stressed upon an awful lot, that he can just cash it in. I don't think there's anything to say where he has to announce it beforehand, or whether he could just go out there, sign it, pass it to Dave Patterson, and he's in the match. That remains to be seen. So that was the VIP pre-show. That's when it was actually a little bit cooler, because the five people that buy general admission tickets weren't in the venue, so it was a little bit cooler there, but it was still a packed packed house. I think there's about over 100 people that were in the show, and it's quite a small-ish venue, and it's the only second time the WrestleZone have ran it, so they've done a remarkable job of trying to maybe try and squeeze a couple extra people in, moving things about to try and get an extra couple seats in there. So they did. The triple threat was fantastic in the end. We'll, like I said, we'll have maybe a bit more in depth on the website through our review and through the road trip episode itself. The main show started off with Ryan Riley and Murphy kicking it off with the Outfit and Foundation of the Future feud battle running through this particular event. Ryan Riley picked up the win over Murphy in a hotly contested match, and it really was. There was a lot of moments where it could have been either or. As with the ticket holder match, there's just a lot of chances where Riley could have finished earlier, a lot of chances where Murphy could have picked up the win. There was a lot of heated debate in the build up to this, whether it was going to end up being one win, a draw. In my head, in my predictions as well, I thought it was going to be Murphy that would pick up the win in this particular match. But Ryan Riley, he showed why he's probably one of the most cerebral assassin in WrestleZone right now. And he picked up the win over Murphy. But it was, like I say, close call. Hopefully see some footage of that very soon. Got Dino and Bruiser Brad Evans were up next. So just for the hilarity for myself, the first time fans that were coming to see WrestleZone, this is the first event they were going to see. They heard the foundation music and the outfit music, and then once that match is over, they heard the foundation music and then the outfit music again. If I was a cruel man, I would have made the first half main event Zach Dynamite versus Ted O'Keefe, just for that, for just a little Groundhog Day hilarity. But Dino and Bruiser Brad, they got into it straight away before the bell. They had a brawl at ringside, which had some absolutely unbelievable chops in that particular match. They were brutal. I think it's to the point, I think Dino lost some chest here from the absolute force of chops that Bruiser Brad was throwing out there. So yeah, chopped, kicked, clubbed, headbutted. They threw everything at each other in this particular match, with Dino eventually picking up the win with his rolling forearm, but Bruiser Brad was out of it. He dropped like a stone in the build-up to the finish. So it looks like that Dino was able to chop down Bruiser Brad Evans for a moment. And maybe he's going to claim himself to be the new Beef King in WrestleZone as well. But no, this was a fantastic match. It was absolutely brutal. Everything you come to expect when it was two big guys that were going to have a big brawl, a big fight, and they delivered it 100%. In the first half main event, we had the triple threat. We had Lost by Aspen, Rhys Dawkins, and Damian. And again, another very hotly contested match. This is the theme of the show, it seems. It was a very, very hot night, not just for us involved in watching the show, being in the Hopeful Social Club, but also for those that were in the ring as well. Lost by Aspen came into this match determined he was going to elbow drop Rhys Dawkins' Shakespeare book, and he delivered it, but not without some fight. Damian interrupted a first attempt. Rhys Dawkins did all he could keep a hold of his book and try and keep it out of the way from the two other competitors. And he almost did it. He did pretty well until finally he succumbed and had to watch Aspen drop an elbow onto his book, onto his book of Shakespeare. It looked like that Rhys Dawkins even powered up a little bit because of it. After he received, I think it was a knee to the face, he powered up, he stood up, he was ready to fight, and then just got hit by a darkest lariat to finally succumb to the pinfall. We saw Lost by Aspen win. Non-title match, so there was no title implications, but there is some momentum being involved there when consider that Aspen's got Vicky Vago on October 21st for the WrestleZone Undisputed Championship. So a little momentum there, and Damian didn't pick up a loss. So he's coming into that match with Captain Allen, which we'll discuss in a moment or two, with maybe not momentum, didn't come away with the win, but he also didn't come away with the pinfall loss as well. So we'll strike that as a mute point, cow's opinion. Back from the break, so we were able to get some photographs with Damian, Lost by Aspen, and Connor Malloy during the interval. I found solace in the bath, the toilets, because it was so cold in there. But thankfully, the staff did have fans going around, and not just myself, but we also had actual fans that go round and round and round and round and cause a draft. And they also opened a fire door during the interval, so people could go out and get a little bit of fresh air, a bit of cold, a bit of breeze before the start of the second half. But it was an absolutely amazing first half of the show, where we're seeing things like the Foundation and that triple threat and the ticket holder match. It was a really, really great first half of the show. Back for the break, we had Ted O'Keefe versus Zach Dynamite, just to cause deja vu from those that saw the start of the first half. We got the Foundation of the Future and the outfit music once more. And this was really interesting. So I came into the preview thinking that Zach was maybe just going to kind of overrun Ted a little bit in this match. But Ted really got the fans on side. He was determined he was going to make Zach tap out with that sharpshooter. Ted got knocked out really early on with a neck breaker on the outside, which really caused him to take a step back and maybe a little bit behind the action, perhaps. But he was able to lock in that sharpshooter, and it looked like Zach Dynamite may have been tapping. He may have just about to tap out until the outfit and the Foundation of the Future arrived en masse to cause a mass brawl to make this match a no contest in the end. So we don't know where this is going to go. We think this is going to be Halloween hijinks, possibly 3-on-3. And we see some chaos at Curl Complex in Aberdeen. We'll have to wait and see. There's no official word as yet. But the absolute chaos, which saw Security Kev get knocked out pretty much. He got his back knocked out. He lost his glasses at some point. Evan Young got a little bit of a dig into him as well, who was working on the crew. Lewis as well. Everyone was involved with piling in, trying to separate these two teams from causing any more damage at Hopeful Social Club. And I'm looking forward to seeing these six clash again in some way or some form. They say, could it be at Halloween Hijinks? Maybe they'll leave it to Christmas Chaos or Stonehaven when they go to Stonehaven in November. So I'll just wait and see. Our penultimate match of the evening was Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed defeating Ronan King and Captain Alan Sterling. To begin to describe this particular match would do a disservice to the absolute hilarity involved. I will just pick out some highlights. We had Ronan King finding out that Captain Alan may possibly be his grandfather. Mr. WrestleZone arrived with gifts. He gave Ronan King a crown because he's an actual king, and Captain Alan a bucket of KFC because he's not a sailor, he's not a captain, he's Colonel Sanders. Things like that. We had Mr. WrestleZone do a styles clash, which I don't think, because we had so many amazing moments like elbow dropping of a book and the barbaric nature of Bruiser Brad Evans Dino, we're forgetting that Mr. WrestleZone did a styles clash to Ronan King, which was phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. Amazing. So we had that. And in the build-up towards the conclusion of the match, Damien appeared on screen to accept Captain Allen's invitational for Halloween hijinks, and he was going to sink his battleship. Damien is not amused by these antics of Captain Allen, but it was enough to distract Allen long enough for Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed to pick up the victory and to pick up another win. These guys are formative. I've got my criticism. I'm thinking, as I think Omar may be getting fed up of Mr. WrestleZone at times, but they're putting in solid performances as a team, and there's got to be some sort of argument that these guys should be in a tag team title match or opportunity at some point down the line, because they're forming quite a formidable team in WrestleZone. Yeah, some results haven't went their way thanks to Dawkins and Tucker and shenanigans that way, but as far as the team goes, they should be looking at a tag team challenge in the future for the titles, whether it's going to be the outfit, whether it's going to be the Foundation of the Future at the end of the day. So before the main event, that was before the main event. The main event was the Tri-County Championship Triple Threat, with Caleb Valhalla retaining for Mickey Vago and Brian Tucker. Another chaotic match, another big brawl on the outside as well. Brian Tucker tried to avoid some of the action, ended up finding himself stuck
at some point between the low roof and the top turnbuckle. We had Mickey Vago use the Green Mist again, which is what he tried to do, which is what he successfully did as well, to retain the title back at Halloween Hijinks when he was Tri-County's champion. So he tried to use that on Rhys Dawkins. Rhys Dawkins had his glasses on, lifted his glasses to proudly show off how he'd avoided it, and then got Green Mist it again as he came to try and help Brian Tucker. Rolled Brian Tucker in the ring at some point as well to try and get him back involved into the match. But Caleb Valhalla eventually lifted up Brian Tucker for the Hell Ride and was able to retain the title for his first defense. And he's marching on towards the, it looks like a challenge against Ronan King. Again, nothing official as yet, but it looks like a challenge that Ronan King made was accepted after Caleb won the title. And besides, after the tag team match, Ronan was very much of the opinion that he's getting that title opportunity at Halloween Hijinks also against Caleb Valhalla, which is a mouth-watering match. I can't wait to see that. I can't wait to see that match itself. So that's it. That's it. Quick recap. Like I said, I want to. I'm going to have so much information about this show through our writing, through on the site, and through the road trip episode of the SWN podcast coming up, which should be Friday, along with some footage and a montage and what have you. So I don't want to keep you any longer than I have to right now. But I've been your host, Billy. If you want to find out a bit more on WrestleZone, check them out on social media. We'll be back with a preview of Halloween Hijinks before October 21st, and I'll be at that show, so we'll have a recap of that event also. They do have a show coming up in November. I'll need to double-check the date, but keep an eye on socials. But in November in Stonehaven, I won't be at that show, so there'll just be a preview, but there won't be a recap of that particular event. Although I can do one with just the results, if you so wish. Just let me know. But thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much for watching. Continue to continue facilitating and encouraging me to do these little podcasts. We'll be back for Halloween Hijinks very soon. Enjoy.